This presentation and all our presentations at this hour block are introductory presentations. And what you're going to find is that we start with the basics and we move to harder topics as we go throughout the day. So over next door, this is your introduction to Quarkus next door, and here's your introduction to Kubernetes and basic Kubernetes components. And then as we graduate to the next section, we are into more details, and the next section, more details and more details. So we drill down throughout the day. But I will have to warn you, and we figure this out, that we probably put too much in the single day. These are all the topics that our team focuses on here at Red Hat. So Edson, myself, and Kamesh will be on the stage after me. You know, this is where we spend all our time. We think about Java and Kubernetes and how to optimize Java-based applications for an OpenShift or Kubernetes environment. How to build next-generation cloud-native applications with microservices and serverless architecture. So we spend a lot of time in this world. And so we decided to bring you all of our topics. And so you're going to see things like really advanced Tecton pipelines as an example. You'll see blue-green, you'll see canary, and you'll see things like basic Kubernetes and basic Quarkus and all that throughout the day. So just be prepared for that. So I know that we're going to have your brains bleeding and melting and falling out of your ears before too long. But this is for people who have not had a chance to really be hands-on with Kubernetes, or if you have been hands-on, maybe you didn't understand certain basic components of it, and we're going to show you an introductory tutorial, if you will. As a matter of fact, all the presentation materials are at this GitHub repo, so make sure you have this link. It's all documented, and you can do it self-service, meaning you can run these materials on your own. And I want you to. And so in other words, what would I do at my Windows laptop or my Mac? You know, how do I download the right things and how do I get started? Hopefully we've documented them nicely there. And the slide deck itself is available at this link down here, bit.ly 9 steps awesome. And I can even tell if you on your phone joined that link, because I can see the fact that, let's say, there's 17 people already joined the deck right there. So it is a live Google document, and you can join right in real time, okay? And so please do so, because we want you to have these materials. Everything we do on our team is open source, because we work at Red Hat. So the slide decks are open source. The materials, the documentation are open source. You can give us a pull request or a GitHub issue if you have a question or you want to actually help us fix something, because these technologies are changing all the time. So let's go ahead and get into it. This 9 Steps to Awesome is a Kubernetes basics class that I typically run over 3 hours. We're going to do it today in less than an hour. Oh, we have Edson coming in on talking to us over here now. Okay, there's also a follow-on 3-hour session on Istio, and we'll do a 1-hour Istio today. There's also 3-hour Knative, and we're going to do a 1-hour Knative today. So you're actually going to get both those things. We've got to unplug the other speaker. flip the switch. There we go. Look at that. It would be kind of entertaining if you had to listen to Edson and myself at the same time, but boy, would that be confusing. Okay? So just be aware that I do run these classes all the time. The next one for the service mesh is August 27th. If you're an O'Reilly subscriber, then you have access to all this material. This also presentation was recorded back at DevOx Belgium in November of last year. So if you want to watch it at your own speed, 3 hours where you can hit pause, or better yet, since I talk so fast, you can actually say, you know, make this video go slower. You don't ever want to take me and go faster in most cases. So, but it is all 3 hours in that recorded session. You definitely should check that out. And of course, this is part of my overall Bruce Lee themed presentation. This is the first movie by Bruce Lee, Fist of Fury. It's totally awesome. Okay, so this scene right here with the nunchucks inside the studio, you got to check that out. This is back before Kung Fu people could fly through the air, you know, and had magic powers, back when they actually had to be real people punching people. Okay? If you remember what we did earlier with Bruce Lee, same kind of thing applies. I show this evolutionary path in all of my presentations, so we won't repeat it now since we did it during the keynote, but this is going from the amoeba phase to the slug phase to the fish phase to the four-legged critter phase to a monkey that looks like Homer Simpson so that you also can be a unicorn and do microservices like the cool cloud-native unicorns in the west coast of the United States, or the startup ecosystem that exists here in Bangalore, as an example. You want to be a unicorn too, but this is where we're going to focus our attention over the next couple hours, because this is where Kubernetes and OpenShift, which is Red Hat's distribution of Kubernetes, and something like an Istio and a Knative and Quarkus, this is where it helps you, okay? So that's what we'll focus on. The 9 steps include all of these components. This is what the 9 look like. We won't have time to get through all of them today because it's normally a 3-hour session, but we will cover the key basics, the key tips and tricks to get you started on Kubernetes, the key components that you have to get your head around so that you'll have access to the Kubernetes capabilities, okay? So you're going to go through these and you're going to see some of them. One I want to really make sure you think about is the live and readiness probe. I want to make sure we get long enough into the session to show you that because that is the secret sauce. Okay, this is the live and readiness probe are the key elements of magic that make Kubernetes do what it does well. And most people mess them up. People forget to set them, which is a problem, and or they set them incorrectly, which is even a bigger problem. And you want to make sure you understand at least how they work at a basic level. Okay, so we're going to talk about that. Because if you get those set correctly, then you get the magic of rolling updates. You get the magic blue-green deployments and things like that. Okay, so a quick introduction. This is the problem space we used to have inside enterprise IT. We used to think about this as old school Java folks. Any old school Java people here in the room? Man, this, you guys are all Python people? Well, I'll tell you, now you can make fun of us old school Java people, right? So back in the day, we would have to build this big old ear file. We would have a big old ear file where we would have, and it's just a zip, a tar, right? It's just a big old ear file. And in there, we would put multiple WAR files, web application archives, and we'd put multiple JAR files in there. We would even throw in our GIF files and our JPEGs and our PDFs and our movies and our video music files, MP4s in there, because we weren't very smart. But that's what we did. And we would take that 10 gigabyte ear file and we'd put it out on a machine which had WebSphere or WebLogic or JBoss, and we would basically FTP it over to that machine and it would restart the app server and load it up, and 5 minutes later you have a server that's online serving requests. That was the world we used to live in. But because I developed on a Windows machine and I had a Linux server over there, it got a little bit weird. And actually, let's say we had a Solaris server, HPUX server, AIX server. So Java was write once, test everywhere for these kinds of issues. So the / or / I'm on Windows, works great over here, doesn't work on Linux or Unix, as an example. Or better yet, the JDBC driver was a different version in that WebSphere WebLogic versus the one I have on my local Tomcat or my local JBoss, right? The JMSQs, data source names, all this configuration had to occur in order for our application to successfully run on the other side of that. And so we would then send an email. Some of you probably are still sending emails. Or how many people are on the ops side of the house? We normally get a lot of ops folks, right? So you ops people receive this email where the developer's like, hey, here's what works on my machine. And you're thinking, your little Windows laptop is not what we have in production. So you have Java 8. We don't have Java 8 in production. You have Wildfly, which is the JBoss application server. We don't have that. We have WebLogic, WebSphere, right? You have this cool MySQL. We don't have that. We have Oracle. We have Red Enterprise Linux in production. So the email you send actually is not even that applicable. Now, I know some of you have evolved from the email to more sophisticated capabilities. You now have a wiki page. And my point is, all of that is still out of date and wrong, okay? So the magic back in 2013, with this thing called the Docker file, taught us a different way to identify our dependencies and our configuration. We could put it all in a single file, and therefore we could check that file in the source code repository, we could have version control of it, and we could then have a consistent environment, both on your laptop as well as in production. Not identical, but at least you could get Linux and Linux. You could get probably the app server and the app server. You could get the basics kind of sort of working the same, even if you're running on Windows over here and Linux over there. So that was a beautiful thing, okay? That was a beautiful thing by itself. But this is where the magic really took off for Linux containers. Then we had this other problem, though. You know, we don't just run one container in production. We run many containers in production. So how do you deal with that? How do you deal with the fact that we want to scale to more than one? We want to scale where there's multiple port conflicts, where all these things run on 8080, if you're familiar with Tomcat or JBoss and servers like that. So as a matter of fact, on my one laptop now, using Minikube, using Minishift, I can run 15 things on 8080 because Kubernetes deals with the port conflicts for me, as an example. So you can win, and there are certain things you win in immediately. You don't have to SSH in and Docker run, Docker run, Docker run. It takes care of that for you. You don't have to deal with the fact that everybody runs on 8080. There's no problem with that either. You can run that across 8080 in the cluster. And so it also deals with the fact that if things fail, it restarts them. It keeps it all running. It keeps it all updated. It helps you manage those images. It basically helps you deal with running these things for real in production. Okay? So Kubernetes is that piece of magic. It came out, as I mentioned, in 2014, open source. We also productized it, made it available to the enterprise in 2015. And now we've been seeing numerous customers running tens of thousands of applications on Kubernetes on-premise or OpenShift even in the public cloud. Okay? So we're seeing a lot of success with this. And it's nice for someone like myself because we got in early on this technology. And sometimes you get in early on a technology and it doesn't play out well. Okay, this is a big win for us because we got in early and it turns out the world has decided the way we want to build software going forward is based on a Kubernetes-based paradigm, not Cloud Foundry, not Mesosphere, not Docker Swarm, but Kubernetes is one and when it comes to the public cloud and private cloud. So Kubernetes is a Greek term, like many things within this world. It means helmsman or governor. And the whole goal of Kubernetes is to manage a fleet of those Docker containers. Think of it as like a bunch of ships in the water, and we've got to manage all of them. So it's a container orchestrator. It works, again, across multiple clouds, pretty much any cloud it runs at this point. And it's inspired by Google's experience with containers. If you actually go back in time, back to 2014, 2015, when Google was bringing this technology to market, they would introduce themselves and this technology as something they were inspired for the last 10 years working within Google data centers. As a matter of fact, they would say, we launch 2 billion containers a week. And so we used to say that too back in 2015 with OpenShift. Hey, customer, are you interested in this highly scalable architecture? Google launches 2 billion containers a week. And of course, the customer in that case was like, well, I got to launch 20. So it was really an incredibly scalable architecture, open source written in Go, and of course you use it to manage applications, not machines. It abstracts the machine away, and you basically now have this thing called a deployment, a pod, a replica set to deal with. I think we may have just lost power for a second, did we? Good thing we have batteries. Okay, so lurked here, self-healing, or they were just playing with the lights. So we have self-healing, we have a horizontal manual and auto-scaling, automatic restarting, scheduled across multiple hosts in the cluster, built-in load balancer, rolling updates, which is what really got people excited. Because in the old days, we used to have to buy this thing from Big IP called F5, and it cost a lot of money. And we'd have to hire special consultants to learn how to configure it. And if our topology changed at all, we'd have to reconfigure it again and get the consultant back. And now you get all that for free here in this architecture. The rolling updates, the server-side load balancing, all of that is part of the architecture, and you don't have to worry about that anymore. It's pretty amazing. Now, we're going to deal with this thing called a pod. You're going to hear POD a lot. The pod is your server running. So your Python running on Flask, which I would not recommend. So your Python running on GUnicorn, right? Your Node.js, your Quarkus app, your Spring Boot app, your WebSphere, your WebLogic, your COBOL, your Fortran, whatever it is that you have to run, that runs in a pod. All right, so that's what we use the term for pod. And a pod is a group of whales, a family of whales. And if you notice the logo for the Docker logo, it's a whale. So it's not the invasion of the body snatchers reference that people like to think about. But some people do refer to this as multiple peas in a pod, a pea pod. Right? Because you can have multiple containers in a pod, and that's a key thing to understand. So if you look at your pod, it can have more than one container. Now, be smart about this. Just because you can put more than one thing in there, that doesn't mean you should. I've had to deal with some people who are like, oh, my whole application is this Tomcat instance with this MySQL. Since I can put both of them in a pod, I'm going to put them both in a pod. That's a really bad idea. Because not only do they share the same IP address, and you might have port conflicts because they are in the same namespace or the same IP address space, but they have the same shared storage, which is ephemeral, not even persistent. And basically, if you restart that pod, the storage goes away. But they have the same shared resources, and more importantly, the shared lifecycle. Do you want to restart your database every time you restart your app server? Almost never, right? So you want to separate the different components of your different containers into different pods, just like you would have if they're virtual machines, just like you would have if they're real hardware, okay? And you have a network in between. We called this client-server back in the day. So you still have that same architectural pattern, right? My app server is separate from my database server, which might be separate from some other microservice app server and some other component within our architecture. So you're going to always have multiple pods running, but you can put more than one container in. So in this early introduction we're going to see today, we're only going to see one for one, one container, one pod. But as we get to Istio, you're going to see two for two, because there's a sidecar container. When we get to Knative, you're going to see three for three, because there's two sidecar containers. So there are very clever things you can do by adding additional containers to a pod, but by normal state, just deal one for one, right? One container, one pod. Now you have this concept of the replica set and the deployment. The deployment, think of that as your template. That is the document you'll create that defines how you want your application to run. I want this container image, right? This Docker image that we did a Docker build to create. I want this image to run. I want it to run two times. I want it to have this liveness probe and readiness probe and these constraints. And you basically, and these labels, and you identify that document as a YAML file. You can check it in the source code repository, and then you can throw it back at the cluster when you're ready to run it. Okay, so that deployment is incredibly important to understand, and the deployment is the actual artifact you deal with. You're not supposed to deal directly with pods. You can, and you'll see that numerous examples on the internet. But by default, the right way to do this is to deal with a deployment, which creates the replica set, which creates the pod. Because the deployment is the declarative state of what you want in the universe. Then you're also going to see these things called services. And this is another core piece of magic that makes everything in Kubernetes so much more scalable, so much more awesome. The service is the stable IP address and the DNS entry for your thing. Your customer service running as a Tomcat-based application, your order service running as a Node.js-based application, your pricing service running as a Python application. Those names, pricing, order, customer, are associated with the service, not the pod. Therefore, the pods can be interchanged out from under it at will. And that is huge. This is why you get the rolling updates. This is why you get the known downtime blue-green deployment. This is why you get all the magic that is Kubernetes. So we'll show you an example of that, and it's documented again in our documentation. You also have this concept of the persistent volume. So what happens if you need to put something on disk and keep it, like a database, as an example, or a Kafka broker, or something of that nature? You use the PV, the persistent volume. And so therefore, you as a developer declare your need for persistence. You basically have a PVC, persistent volume claim, and then underneath, the infrastructure will provision the appropriate storage that is represented on that cloud provider. Like if I do it on Amazon, you'll see a new GP2 storage show up, as an example. So you basically say what kind of storage you want, and then the storage gets provisioned for you underneath the cluster. Now, if you're a cluster administrator, you do have to figure that out, but as a developer, you can ignore it. You just simply say you need persistence. And then labels are key elements of this architecture. You have to get your head around labels, and we'll spend a little bit more time on it, because this is how all the magic happens in this universe. The key value pair, and that's all it is A equal B, Burr equals Sutter, Bangalore equal awesome. It's just a simple name value pair, but this is how everything works in this architecture, okay? So you have the Kubernetes cluster that we mentioned earlier. You have dev and ops, both of who use the various command line tools or user interfaces, graphical tools, to interact with the API. And then, of course, API interacts with the database, known as etcd. And you have your schedulers or your controllers. Notice there's always three of these, because you need a quorum for etcd. You want high availability should anything fail. You don't want to lose your cluster. So you have high availability, so always three. And then you have mini worker nodes. You can have one. I would never recommend one, but you would probably at least have two, and you could have as many as you want. So some people really run 1,000 of these things, literally 1,000 worker nodes as an example, and you can put as many cores and memory underneath those worker nodes as you want. And therefore, you now might have 1,000 cores available to work with. You might have a few terabytes of memory to work with, and that's what you give your that's what your cluster resources are. The cool thing about that 1,000 cores and 2 terabytes of RAM is it's now available to all the pods. And that's the whole point. The cluster now looks like one big old computer, if you will, from the point of view of those pods, right? They're just going to be scheduled wherever they can fit. And the scheduler is clever. If it sees one of these nodes that are overloaded, it won't add more load to it. It'll basically say, hey, you got any more space available? And the kubelet says, nope, no more space available here, right? It goes someplace else, right? So it tries to be clever about that. And there's a lot of different rules and algorithms that are related to the scheduling, but this is the intro presentation, and we're not going to worry about that. Just assume it's magic for now. You have this concept of labels, though, that I mentioned earlier, and you can see we have appcool, envprod, version 1, but look at it from this perspective. Appcool applies to all those wildflies in the entire cluster. So we have 4 pods that match the label appcool. 4 pods. So you can actually say kubectl get pods dash l, app cool, and you're going to get 4 responses back, okay? And then you can look here, well, if it's app cool and env dev, then I get 2 responses back. So that's my dev environment, but notice it's still version 1 and version 2. And those labels, by the way, are just arbitrary strings you create. So don't assume this really means production or really means development or really means 1 or 2. It's whatever you decide, okay? But this is a way for you to segregate these workloads across the cluster. Here's env prod. So you just have to be aware of this, because you often will segregate your application workloads with just different labels. Often you'll see me use a little version 1, version 2, version 3 just for fun, just because then I can do my blue-green deployment testing or my canary deployment testing. You'll see that when we do the Istio presentation and other things as an example. And you can see here's version 1 versus version 2. So it's easy to basically get these labels wrong, and I'll try to show you an example of how to have a little fun with them, okay? We won't go into great detail here, but it's fairly straightforward. You're going to use the API server to create a deployment, create your object. Here's my document. It's going to write it to etcd, and of course, it's going to let you know, yep, we got your declaration. We know what you want. And then, of course, the scheduler is going to talk to the kubelets, and it's going to do that Docker run on your behalf, okay? And so you don't have to do a Docker run anymore. It takes care of it for you. And that's kind of really the whole point of this. As a matter of fact, it's not even a Docker run any longer, depending on which version of the Kubernetes you have. It's another way to start a container. So keep that in mind. These are the key commands you're going to be dealing with. So kubectl get namespaces, get pods. You can do a kubectl run. I'll show you that, though it's now deprecated. You can expose the deployment. So in other words, you can do this to create the pod, and then you do this to expose this to create the service. And now you have a service endpoint to talk to the pod, as an example. And then, of course, you can scale the deployment. You can change the image out from underneath the deployment. So now I can go from version 1 to version 2, and it'll do the rolling update with just that one command. But these are the imperative ways to use the command line tool. And often they're not recommended, but it's a good way to get started. It's a good way to just to see if you can make anything run. So that's why we show you these things up front. And then we'll show you the more advanced ways. So that's all good. So let's kind of dive right into the 9 steps. And we'll show you some of these things. So we actually, in this presentation and in our documentation, tell you to use Minikube or Minishift. And here's why. You can certainly spin up a cluster on Amazon or Google or IBM or wherever you have your cloud provider. It could be that inside your data center, someone has given you access to spin up clusters. But it's also awesome to be able to set one up on your laptop. Now, I'll tell you right up front, if you only have an 8 gigabyte of RAM laptop and a 2-core machine, yeah, that might not cut it, okay? So if you have a laptop that's old or that underpowered, you know, put it this way, that's the kind of laptop you'd give to a child. You want to get a real laptop, okay? A laptop with 16 gigabytes of RAM, a laptop with 4 cores, and then you can do some interesting stuff. It should be noted, you can make Minikube, Minishift, or at least Minikube, which is smaller than Minishift, run on a 8 gigabyte, 2-core machine, but it's going to be sluggish, and you're not going to be able to do much with it. As a matter of fact, you're going to want to deploy that Spring Boot application into it, and Spring Boot takes so much memory that you're not going to be able to run mini pods inside it. And you certainly can't deploy Istio, which runs as another set of pods, or Knative, which runs as another set of pods, and also needs more cores, and make it all happen. So if you have a 16 gig machine and a 4-core machine, you can dedicate 2 of those cores to the VM, you can dedicate 8 gigabytes of RAM to the VM, and now you got some, you can go. You got some stuff there, right? You can have some fun. So just bear that in mind. But I do love Minikube and Minishift, and they're very, very powerful. Again, you can also find a hosted solution for this as well, and there's many, many options, right? You can set up your own raw VMs at your favorite cloud provider and use kubeadm and just configure your own cluster wholly manually. You know, you can do, there's lots of ways to get one at this point in time. So let's you're talking Docker? Yes, so here you can see, the point was, you can see Docker Desktop, which I do have running here. It also has a Kubernetes inside it as well. I never spend any time on this one, though. This is one I don't use. So I don't really know if it works or doesn't work. Yeah. And I always use the Minikube because it is the more pure way of doing things. So I actually have Minikube here. So Minikube, let's see what version I have. And you can see So it says Minikube version 1.1, even though I put in a directory called 120. I got to figure that out. I must have set the path wrong, but it should work. And then I have a Minikube profile, and I use the profiles a lot. And in this case, it's set for the next presentation, so it should be Knative. And you'll do things like IP, so what is the IP address of that? And you'll do SSH, and you can SSH into the VM, and you can do things like PS-EF, right? And it should be noted that when you're in the virtual machine, which in this case is VirtualBox right here, this is the guy that's running, I did an SSH into that virtual machine right now, and now I can actually ask the virtual machine, what does it know? So it actually has Kubernetes components running, right? Let's see here, you got that. And then you can also, once you start launching pods, you'll see those processes here too. So that's an important thing to get your head around. A pod, which can be multi-container, but those containers are nothing more than Linux processes that you can see at the host level. So you can get into single node and look around. And you can kill minus nine things if you want, right? But you shouldn't. Okay, you shouldn't do it that way. But you can do things like PS. You can do, you know, how much memory do I have? Let me make sure I'm not running out of RAM. Let me make sure I'm not running out of disk in here. You know, what's performing? And you can see what I've done here. It looks like I've given this thing four CPUs. And so, because I have enough CPUs, and I've given it, what, 18 gigabytes of memory? I don't remember doing that. But I've given it a lot of memory. And then you have access to that virtual machine. So it is a virtual machine running a little mini cloud on your laptop. That's what Minikube and Minishift are doing for you. So in our documentation, as I mentioned, we talk about setup and installation and getting started. You can see we talk about you do need Docker for Mac or Docker for Windows at a minimum to get Docker build, right? So you do need to use the Docker build tool to get an image created. That's something actually Red Hat is working on. We're working on a thing called Podman to give you a separate tool for doing image builds. But it's not really available on Mac and Windows. It's really just for Linux at this point. A bash shell is what we always show all our documents in. So for those of you on Windows, I recognize you might be using cmd.exe or PowerShell. We just have not had the time to document those shell commands. So you'll have to translate bash to whatever your shell is, or get a bash shell for Windows, which there are several available now. So we always document everything in bash shell. We always use git, right? Git, right? You need to be able to git clone things. You'll git clone this repository to your local hard drive so you have access to all this. We also love Homebrew for Mac, so you'll install this thing called Stern. Stern is a great logging tool for Kubernetes, so you can see additional logging capability. We also tell you to install this thing called kubectx, which allows you to change your context from one cluster to another more easily. I'm gonna point at cluster A versus cluster B versus cluster C. It also has a tool in there called kubens for basically pointing to a different namespace within a cluster. So I want to switch from namespace A to namespace B to namespace C. It's really nice. And then, of course, Minikube Minishift, and you'll have to have your command line tool, kubectl, 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 lots of different names for this thing. So some people call it kubectl, some people call it kubectl, some people call it kubectl, like cuddle, you know, we're going to cuddle each other. So kubectl is the proper name for it, but everybody kind of messes that up. You'll hear it different ways. And also there's OC. If you're dealing with a Minishift, you'll use the OC command line tool for at least login. So by default, OpenShift, one difference between OpenShift and Kubernetes is it's secure by default, and therefore you have to log into it, right? And therefore you need an OC login command. We at Red Hat, by the way, are the second largest contributor to Kubernetes overall, right, outside of Google themselves. And we also work on these command line tools. So kubectl is a tool that we are engineers for, as an example. So it's funny that we have the two different command line tools available, but they work almost identically. You can interchange them, you know, in most cases. Here's how do you get the kubectl client tool, different ways to install it. You can brew install it, or you can curl it and get it downloaded. You know, get a Minikube cluster, get a Minishift cluster, all that's here. If we're doing it the 3-hour version of this, people are doing it with me, but we don't have time for that now. Get your environment variables set up correctly, so you have the right Minikube. You can do a Minikube version. I just showed you the SSH, but look right here. This is how you get their profile configured and the right memory and CPUs dedicated to it. So 2 cores and 6 gigs of RAM for this elementary stuff gives you plenty of headroom to run a number of pods. And then, of course, you would set your VM driver. See, I set it to VM driver VirtualBox. I'm only using VirtualBox because it's available on every platform. It's available on Windows, it's available on Linux, it's available on Mac, so that's what I like to use. A lot of people love HyperKit on Mac. They swear by it. A lot of other people love VMware, because that's what they have. You might have Hyper-V on your Windows machine. You just have to look for the various options there that make sense to your platform. But I use VirtualBox everywhere. And you can also see, you can specify which Kubernetes version you really want to use. So you notice I set it to 1.12 here, because that is the most common Kubernetes available in production environments around the globe. In other words, you'll find it at Amazon, you'll find it at Google, you'll find it at Red Hat, you'll find it based on your different vendors. Yes, there is a Kubernetes 1.14 and maybe even 1.15. I haven't looked in a couple weeks, but no one actually supports the latest, greatest. Nobody. So you have to decide which version you want to be on based on what you have from your vendor. If you're an Amazon person, it's 1.12 or 1.13, as an example. If you're Google, I think it's still 1.12 or 1.13. No one really has, not too many people have 1.14 at this point. Okay, so you want to set that. And then, of course, if you're Minishift, you want to enable the admin user. Again, you want the admin user capability. And then you can see it says start. So that's how you start it up, and that's what I've done. I have start running. And then you're going to have, like, here's my virtual box. And you can see I can run Minikube and Minishift simultaneously, side by side. I've done that on many occasions. Not a problem there. The only thing you'll want to be able to do is switch your kube config environment variables so you can have multiple clusters running simultaneously on one machine. You don't really want the kube configs to overlap each other. So you'll actually see that in my setup here. Let's see here. Let me open up. This is the directory you'll clone. Nine Steps Awesome, you'll clone it. And you'll see that I have this thing here. Often, not set context. Where is it? Start Minikube. So there's the start command that we just saw there that I have here as a shell script. Oh, it looks like I don't have it set here. And in a lot of my other examples, you will see that I actually have a thing I put out there. So let's look at Knative here, which we'll talk about in the next section. Let's see here. You'll see this is set env. So this is a very common thing you'll see in a lot of my directories. So you should be aware of how to configure your path, and more importantly, how to configure kube config path, so you can keep your world separate. I keep the kube config over here for this profile, kube config over there for that profile, kube config over here for this cluster, that cluster, only because I like keeping the world separate. And that's also a file, by the way, you can blow away and it'll get recreated. And often the system will get confused, it can't find the cluster you're talking about because your kube configs have gotten confused. So this is a very advanced technique, but be aware that it is very nice. Maybe I should say if you're new to this, maybe you shouldn't set it. Just let it go to the default location on your hard drive. That's documented, by the way, in our document. Also, the kube editor trick is very, very powerful. I use that a lot. So right now, you can see it's mapped to VS Code right there. And so if I go back to my tool, so echo kube editor, you can see I have it set here, but I don't have it set here. All right, so it's not set here. So what this tool allows you to do, let's see, kubectl, get deployments, all namespaces. I'm just looking for something that's in this cluster. I don't have much here. I have Knative installed and Istio installed. But let's just play with something. Kubectl, edit, deployment. And then we're going to go with autoscaler. In Knative serving, so the namespace. When I do the edit here, Knative serving, there we go. You notice it puts me in a VI-like tool. So that's what happens if you don't have that environment variable set. And so you have to know how to escape VI, which is incredibly hard, right? It's one of the most common questions on Stack Overflow. How do you save and escape VI? But if you do this same command over here, okay, with that environment variable set, it throws you into Visual Studio Code. And now you can edit it with an editor that you might be more comfortable with. And for those of you on Windows, you might want to put it in Notepad, right? I'm not sure if that would work for Notepad, but I never tried it, but you could. And then you just have to save it, close it. If you don't, you have to close it. Don't forget to close it. And then you'll notice that command is locked until you actually close it, okay? And then it persists the document back to the actual API server and back in the etcd. So what I just showed you, though, is a way to live edit in-memory documents, in-memory declarations. And you do that for experimentation's sake, but you don't really do that for a real production environment, obviously. Okay? You would update the actual file on disk instead. All right, so this is all the kind of tools you would have. You can see different options here, get pods, all namespaces. Do remember this all namespaces trick, because you will have things running that you don't know are running. And in this case, since I've installed Istio and Knative into this Minikube, by default, you don't have these. Okay, I'm also prepared for the next presentation. You can see there's a ton of pods using memory and CPU on this virtual machine already. So that's why I have to give it so much memory and so much CPU, because there's a ton of things running already inside that system. And a regular Minikube, you only see a handful of things running. But it should be noted that Kubernetes deploys itself as Kubernetes. In other words, all the things that you want to run are running also as pods and as deployments within Kubernetes. So that's something you have to get your head around. It's a little bit like Inception, you know, the fact that all of this is here. And so just be aware of that. I showed you this SSH command already. And you can basically, if you're a Minishift, you will need to log in. And the default username and password is admin. And then you can use these tools like kubens and kubectx to manage, you know, switch context, switch namespaces. And so let's show you this. Let's see. Let's go here, run this command. So I'm gonna let me see what namespace I'm in. I don't have a default namespace, meaning one that is sticky. Let's make it sticky. And it's just use default here. Kubeness. All right, so it's now highlighted in yellow. So that's why I like that tool. Because if you don't use Kubeness, you now have to specify the namespace everywhere you go. Okay? This makes it sticky. What is my namespace I want to work within? Let me run this command now here. So you can see it's kubectl. That's the tool you're always using. Run. Hello Minikube is the name of the deployment that's going to get created, and pull this image from the Google repository. GCRIO is the Google repository. You might see Docker.io, which is Docker Hub. You might see the Red Hat registry here. You might see some other registry. Quay.io is also very popular now. You'll see tons of that. And you'll notice that when I hit return here and hit run, it does say this command will be deprecated or is deprecated and may be removed. So just be aware of that, because you're not really supposed to use this tool, but look what happens. Okay, kubectl, git pods. There's now a hello minikube that's in container creating status. So in other words, it's bringing that image up and making it run. In other words, it's doing its Docker run. Okay, if I do kubectl get all, there's actually a bunch of things here. Okay, let's see here. All right, there's a bunch of things here. Some of these you can ignore because there's part of Knative, which is, again, a more advanced concept, but there's the pod. You can see that it's now one for one. One container in that pod is ready. If you see zero for one, you're not ready. So one for one is critical. You want to see it running here. You have a service, which, again, this is a standard service you see in a minikube. This service has nothing to do with what we're dealing with here right now. And you have a deployment, and you have a replica set. So that one run command created my deployment, which created my replica set, which created my pod. Okay, so know that those three things were created by that one run command. And now you have to, if you want to tear it down, you have to clean these things up appropriately. Okay, so with that run command, we now have a deployment, we have a pod, and we can even do things like this. We can say kubectl get pods again. All right, so there's my pod. I can say kubectl exec IT into that pod, bin bash. So I can essentially SSH into the pod. And let's see here, curl localhost. I forget what port it's running on. What did it say? Did it say 8080? Yeah. So that's an Nginx running inside that pod. That's all that's in there. And it's running on 8080, and you can see I can interact with it. But I can't interact with it on the outside. Because all I have right now is the replica set, kubectl get rs. I have a deployment. And I have a pod. That's the three things that were created. So if I want to interact with it for real, I would have to do a service. So here, let me create a service. And on Minikube or Minishift, you often use this thing called a node port. And so we will basically do that, expose the node port. If I say kubectl now get services, there's a service, hello Minikube, type node port, and look at this number right here. That's the magic number. That is the external number mapped to the internal port. So 8080 is the internal one, but what's visible to the outside world is this thing called 32731. And I can say minikube dash p, and Knative is what I call the profile. IP, it's 192.168.99.101. I can say curl 192.168.99.101 colon, and it was 32731. And now I'm interacting with that application server, that Nginx. Okay? So, and that's from the Mac, the host, or the Windows machine, into the VM, into that specific pod that's running. So that you just have to remember these techniques because it can get confusing. People can't talk to the thing they just launched. They forgot to create the service, or they forgot to create the service with a node port. Because if you just use a regular load balancer, then you gotta go configure a load balancer, and that's very doable. You can configure the load balancer there. Let's see if this screen comes back online. It's thinking about it, there we go. And you would do that if you're dealing with a AKS, IKS, GKE, EKS. Anybody who gives you a cluster has their way of doing what's called ingress, a load balancer, and that inbound, you know, how do you get from the outside world to the inside world? So just bear that in mind. That is unique per cluster, okay? OpenShift does it a certain way using HAProxy. We call that a route. All you do is simply say expose a route, and you now have a routable endpoint. Minikube, you would use node port like I'm using here, or you would add ingress gateway capability to it, which you'll see some of that later. Or in the case of GKE, EKS, they'll have their own solution for that. So you just have to keep that in mind, right? The way you get an external load balancer or a route can be tricky. You can also use something like this, right? It'll tell you the service URL as well, and OpenShift has something similar in Minishift. And then you can describe your deployment. Let's do that, kubectl, describe, deployment, hello minikube, and dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. So you can see a description, and it's important to know this command. So you have kubectl apply, create, replace, run. These are commands to create things, get things running. Replace is to update, delete to remove it. Okay, so you have your typical create, read, update, delete commands. But you also have describe, tell me about that thing, which is very powerful. And this is essentially pulling out the document from etcd as to what the description of that thing is. In other words, it's pulled the YAML out of the database. Okay, you can look at it here. You can basically look at it in various ways, you know, JSON form, YAML form. In this case, this is what describe shows you. You can kind of see, well, it's set up for rolling update. It is, here's the image that we're going to be using. Where's that image declaration? Yeah, there's the image. The port that is exposed, 8080. You'll also see if, depending on if there's some errors that occurred, you know, you might see some error messages here based on the fact that couldn't deploy it or something like that. So you might see that also. But that describe command is very, very powerful. And then, of course, there's the edit command that I showed you earlier. Okay, so you can actually edit the document. And so now I want two replicas. Hit save, close, watch kubectl get pods. And you'll see a second one has come online. So that declarative capability is very, very powerful. So I can do the same thing over here, kubectl, edit, deployment. Hello, minikube. And now I'm in VI mode, so let's look for replicas again. There it is. And then I let me go talk to it. Oh, yeah, there we go. So we found it. Here we go. I didn't want to do that. All right, there. And we want three. Save, WQ, bang. And then you'll see a third one come to life up top there. So that declarative concept is really what makes Kubernetes so awesome. You say, I want three of those now. I want to change the image information, and it'll just keep trying to make the world the way you've asked it to look like, okay? So if I can come in here now and change that again, replicas, and let's go here. I keep hitting the wrong command. All right, there we go. One, let's make it one. And then you'll see it take two of those away. Because it said you don't want three of those anymore. So you see they're terminating, and it does take a little while to clean up a pod because it is a real living, breathing thing, right? It's trying to get it to shut down gracefully at this point. So just keep that in mind. Very powerful stuff, and that's all here in step one, okay? So let's talk about the next step, the next most important step in this, and that is, besides installation and getting started, it's how to build an image. And so the way you build an image is also very important. So some key tips to take away from this session, you know, besides what we're showing you in terms of the tutorial part of it, is your base image, you need to be very specific about where you get that thing from, okay? In other words, where did it come from? Who created it? What did they stick in there? Did they fix all the critical vulnerabilities or not? You want to make sure your base images are coming from a known vendor you trust. Somebody who's helping you create this thing correctly. And I'm not just saying that because Red Hat provides these things, but most people just pull these from Docker Hub, and Docker Hub has numerous base images in there that have all kinds of critical vulnerabilities in there. You also don't know what backdoor someone might have put in there as well, because you've got to keep in mind, when you load that base image, it's going to run the thing in Linux that they want to run, the stuff in the path, the stuff that boots automatically. So if they want to put a Bitcoin miner in there, and you want to run it, you know, they probably could do that. As a matter of fact, for those of you who actually manage infrastructure at scale, have you guys had to chase down a few Bitcoin miners on your infrastructure and shut them down? So I see you're nodding your head. This is what happens to people running real operations at scale. You actually have people Bitcoin mining on your infrastructure, and you're paying for it. I mean, it happens, for real. We have people at Red Hat. That's what they do, chase down Bitcoin miners on our infrastructure. Okay? So you have to figure out your base image is, know where it's coming from, what registry it's coming from. You notice I said Docker.io, Quay.io, GCR.io. There's also a container catalog at Red Hat. Those are the pristine images that we ensure are clean and happy. And actually, now that we're here, let me bring that up. Let's just to see if we can get Red Hat container catalog, because this is a question I got a lot recently, so let's go ahead and open that up. Because someone was asking, well, how do we know that the image even come from Red Hat is any good? I'm like, okay, that's a fair question. So let me go to Java here, since I'm a Java person, and you can see right there our base Java image. was updated 2 days ago. It has a health rating of A, and then you can get more information about what was changed about it, things like that. So we actually are trying to publish real good data about what, you know, the most recent build of that image, things of that nature. And so that is the one we recommend for people doing OpenJDK-based image, as an example. Okay? So just be aware of that. Also know you have to craft your Docker file. You then have to do your Docker build. And then, of course, if you are on a remote cluster, so if you're using GKE, AKS, EKS, a remote cluster, a remote OpenShift, meaning one not on your laptop, you do have to do a Docker push in addition to a Docker build. Right? You Docker build to get the image, and then you Docker push to get the image where you need it to be so that Kubernetes can pull it. Okay? If you're on Minikube or Minishift, there's a trick to it, and I'll show you what that trick is. But once you've got your Docker image created, you then kubectl apply your deployment, you kubectl apply your service. You could put all that in one file. I never do. I like having them separate because I like, you know, tweaking them separately. But you could put them in one file and put those in source control, and then you're good to go. So it's that four-step process. Figure out what your image is going to be, get your Docker file, Docker build, apply, apply. All right, so just think of those basic steps. So let's see if we can kind of walk you through that. All right, let's go over here and here. And I'm going to, and by the way, this again is all documented and step two. And I'm going to just show you my version of it right now. But it does walk you through these basic concepts. The first thing you'll notice, it says create a namespace. Okay, so I'm going to create a namespace, kubectl create namespace. And there's different ways to create a namespace. I'm going to call this MySpace. And I'm going to say kubens MySpace, so it's sticky now. I'm inside it, so kubens. So MySpace is the active one. I don't have to specify the namespace any longer. I'm in the Spring Boot directory. Let me look at the code for that. Let's bring that editor. You can kind of see this Java code basically is very straightforward. It grabs the environment variable of the host name. This becomes important later. Like, what is this computer that I'm running on? All right, it has a simple counter that allows me to know if the JVM is being started or stopped again. Because it's a, you know, it's just a stateful variable. So by the way, when people say, oh, you have to be fully stateless, you do not. You can be stateful as well. You just have to know what you're doing with that. That's actually one of the big wins of Kubernetes, is you can do stateful applications in addition to stateless applications. And so I can say, look at my greeting. Let's actually change this to namaste. Okay. And then you can see it says from Spring Boot right there. And then there's some other request mappings. Tell me about your resources. Actually consume all your resources. Just be aware of that. So there's my code. So as a Java programmer, I'm going to say maven clean compile package. That's what us Java programmers do all day. We go get coffee while this build is occurring, right? I make that point because if you see it Quarkus, you don't have time to go get the coffee, right? Quarkus is too fast. But let me go here. I can say java-jar, target, and then boot demo. I'm going to java-jar it. So that basically runs the fat jar. So there it came up in 2.6 seconds. Curl localhost 8080. Let's see how that works. All right, it says namaste from Spring Boot. Notice the variable there, 1, 2, 3, goes up. It says unknown, because it doesn't know what the host name is right now, but that's okay. That's our code. So we think our Java code is ready, right? So that's what the developer does. Now they got to figure out, well, how do we build the image? So I'm going to use this Docker file, which actually is not a good one, but we're trying to make a point here. So it's pulling from Docker Hub. So if you don't see a registry name up there, it's going to Docker Hub, okay, by default. Unless you're on Red Enterprise Linux 8, in which case it defaults to our registry before it goes to Docker Hub, okay? So you have to know what the paths are, if you will, to know where it's coming from, but by default, Docker Hub is the default. Environment variable there to name the jar file, the fat jar, and it's gonna copy it to the right directory, and it's gonna do a java-jar. In other words, what you just saw me do on the command line, the Docker file is doing too, okay? So we're trying to make this super simple. So you're gonna have to build that image, kubectl, Docker build dash T, 9 steps, awesome. Let's make sure we spell this correctly. I've often misspelled it because it's so complicated. My boot v1 and dot. So we're doing our Docker build there. Now notice it did a Docker build really fast because I've done a build before. All right, I'm cheating here. There's nothing being downloaded at this point in time. But watch this. This is very important to get your head around. Docker host. See that environment variable? It's set to the same virtual machine IP address as the whole Minikube is sitting in right now. And the port number for the Docker daemon, 2376, is also configured. This means my Docker build that I just used is actually talking to the Docker daemon in Minikube, not the Docker daemon running at Docker for Mac. So this is an important tip to get your head around. So in other words, it's not talking to this guy. It's talking to Minikube here. So To make that point, if I do a Docker PS, look at all this stuff that's running. Okay? And actually, let's do this. Docker host. Yeah, so that's set, so it's unset. Docker host. And now if I do a Docker PS here, okay, it's actually trying to talk to, I know what the issue is. There's a couple other environment variables there. So minikube-p, knative, docker env. Let's see what other environment variables I had. Okay, so there's Docker host and cert path. I think I need to unset all those to get it to go back, so unset. And then let's unset this one too. But this is the trick. I'm showing you the way to undo it if you need to, so Docker PS. So you'll notice Docker images here is different than my Docker images here. Okay, so this one has grep, 9 steps. That's the one we just created. But this also, this Docker images has Istio in here. It has Knative in here. Let's see, this one, grep, Knative, no Knative, no Istio. Because there's two different Docker daemons I'm talking to. So I recognize this is kind of hard to get your head around, but this is very important that you figure out. But because I'm working with the Docker daemon and minikube or minishift on my local machine, which is fine, because it's okay that that port is open on your local machine, it's not okay to open it up across the internet. You don't want people doing Docker build across your cluster on the internet, or Docker run on your cluster across the internet. So any operations team was going to close that port down. That's why it never works on a remote cluster from your machine, but it works fine on your machine, okay? If you, again, if you don't have a local cluster like we have right now, you would do a Docker build on your local Docker daemon and then Docker push it someplace else, right? Docker tag and Docker push. So in this case, I don't have to push it someplace else. It is there and available to me. So here you can see it says grep 9 steps. That's the image I created. 9 steps also, my boot. And if we look at our docs here, dun, 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 let's, and so here we did that already. We did that already. And now you can basically do a, it actually is always a good idea, by the way, to do a Docker run after you do a Docker build just to check that the container is happy. We know the JVM was happy. Let me see if the container is happy. Okay, there's our Spring Boot coming up. There, it took about 4 seconds to start a Hello World Spring Boot. But let's do this now. It is curl 192.168.99.101.101.80.80. And there I'm interacting with it. Now, you'll notice I put the IP address of the minikube there, not localhost anymore, because that's Docker runs happening in the Docker daemon inside that virtual machine, okay? That's another thing that tends to confuse people. So, but you can see at least the Spring Boot application is running, and it looks pretty happy there. So now we need to make it a Kubernetes pod. So if you look here, there's a directory called kubefiles, my deployment, my boot deployment YAML. Let's go look at that file. Okay, let's open this up. And so here it is. I was apparently looking at it earlier. And you can see that it's very straightforward. It basically has some labels and metadata. It says I want one of these. It has how to match the selector for when we actually do our selection of this thing. And then really the part that matters is this one called spec with containers, with the name of the container, and the image that you want to load that container, and the port that it exposes. So very straightforward, kind of what we saw with our Docker run command, because this is the part that matters to us, but this is the document we're going to throw into our Kubernetes cluster, okay? And then you can see right here, kubectl create, right there. So let's just do that, kubectl, and you can use apply as well. Kubectl create, my boot deployment, what was it called? Dash deployment, okay, come back, there we go. Deployment.yaml, and we go, and watch, kubectl, get pods. You notice, and I don't specify the namespace because I use the kubeNS trick, right? Otherwise, you'd have dash n namespace everywhere we're doing every command. All right, so it looks like that guy is up. So then we can come back to our document, and we'll create our service. So you can kind of see, let's actually do that real quick. Now there's not only the pod, kubectl get all, and you can see there's the knative stuff, which you can ignore, but there's the deployment, the pod, and the replica set. Those three guys were created. So we created the deployment object, which created the replica set, which created the pod, and again, the deployment object was defined here, and you notice the kind deployment, right? The kind is very critical there to know what type you have. And so let's go back over here, and let's create our service. Okay, so it's myboot-service, kubectl, apply-f, myboot-service. And there we go. Now we have a service coming online. It says kubectl get all again. And we should see a service right there. And notice it is, there's a 31.712. That's that node port again. So that's how we'll talk to it. So curl 192.168.99.100.101. And it was, what was that number? 30, there we go, let's get that number. And let's see if we can curl it. And now we're talking to it as a pod, okay? So we can say while true, let's do this somewhere else actually, let's do this here. While true, do curl, get this curl command, dun, dun, dun. And sleep one, done, did I do that right? All right, so there we go. So it's curling now, hitting that server. And you can see, based on the number going up, we're dealing with the same JVM instance. That pod is still up. It's still alive, right? So let's watch this now. So let's go over here and say, watch kubectl get pods. OK, so there it is. Let's have a little bit more fun with this. Kubectl, kubectl get deployments. I'm just switching windows here. I do this a lot, so I can see different things happening in different windows. So kubectl edit deployment, my boot. Let's see if that'll bring up Visual Studio Code. Let's change it to two replicas. So I'm going to hit save, close, and then watch what happens here. There's a second one coming up, and notice those error messages. Did you see them? This is important, okay? The reason you got those error messages is because that deployment does not have a liveness probe and readiness probe. This is why these things are so critical. I did not specify those two probes, and I'll show you what those look like before we're finished here. And because I didn't specify, during this rollout, the load balancer, the service, didn't know that that pod really wasn't ready yet. That JVM was still booting, that Spring Boot was still loading, that architecture was still coming up, and therefore it was rejecting requests to it. If you have those two probes set correctly, it won't send traffic to a pod that's not yet really, really ready. Okay? So that's why it's important. But you can see we are load balancing across the two of them pretty nicely. You know, it's working, we're load balancing. If I come in here and change it yet again, let's go back to one. Okay, let's go to replicas one. Save, close, all right, and you can see one's terminating now, so you can see it goes to the one that's remaining. So the load balancing you get for free. All I'm doing here is a curl command. That's actually pretty awesome all by itself. Again, if you had to buy a big IPv5 router and all that other stuff that came with it, right, this is pretty amazing to kind of get this capability. So out of the box, okay. So that is basically our step two. You can kind of play with it, you can, and look at it, and so there's all the commands. You can go in there and update the code, and of course, do the Maven package again, do your Docker build again, and then you can roll out that new image. Actually, let's just do that real fast. Code, go here. My controller, instead of namaste, I originally was born in Hawaii, so I'll make it say aloha. Okay, I'll do a Maven clean package to basically get a new fat jar created. So there we go, come on. So we can do java-jar target, and it was called my boot, I can't remember, what was the name of the file? Boot demo, right? So java-jar target boot demo, run that, curl localhost. I want to test my code as a good Java programmer. Yep, it says aloha now, fantastic. I'll do my Docker build, -t, 9 steps, awesome. My boot, call this version 2, dot. Okay, so now it's going to do a new Docker image for us, so Docker images, grep, 9 steps. There we go, we have 1 and 2 now. And if you'll notice in the docs, we say how do you do the update? We're going to do the rolling update, so we're going to basically tell the deployment to change its image from v1 to v2. And as a matter of fact, let's do this kind of a more fun way. Where'd my edit go? Let's see, where's the image? I can just do it this way too. Save. Now again, you're not supposed to do this in a real production environment, but kubectl, get pods, okay? And you notice it did fail again, because it didn't know it wasn't live and ready, but it did change. It's now in aloha. If I want to change it back to the namaste version 1, I can. Right, so where to go? Here we go, back to version 1. Save, close, and it fails again, okay? So the last piece I do want to show you is the live and readiness probe. Let's see if we can fix that behavior, because this is probably the most fundamental thing to understand. So we're going to actually skip a few steps here to step 7, Live and Readiness Probe. And so the Live and Readiness Probe is just another piece of YAML that you add to your deployment descriptor. And all you got to do is simply specify where you want the probe to call into. So let's actually look at that. Let's go here. Yeah, let's go here. This is where I had the right directory. And so this one has it right here. Okay. And actually, let me comment this part out. Since we skipped that step, we don't have the configuration. But you can have a declarative configuration environment. But look here. We have the myboot version 1, 8080, just like we had before. So that part didn't change at all. But now we've done some additional things. We've actually constrained its resources, because we don't want the JVM to suck up all the memory on the machine, which it likes to do. Okay, literally, if you guys have dealt with Java, it'll eat all the memory on the machine, if you're not paying attention. So we are going to contain the memory. We're going to contain the CPU, because it can't grab all the CPUs too, because it will by default. And when you, by the way, when you deploy your Apache Spark or your Kafka, you'll see it happen. Okay, so you want to know those how to configure those resources. But then you see the liveness probe and readiness probe. So the liveness probe is the first check. Are you alive, yes or no? And if you don't say yes to this probe, you're not alive. As a matter of fact, it will try to delay the probe. So it'll launch you, then delay 10 seconds, like said here. Then it'll ask you the question, are you alive? It'll do this every 5 seconds, and it'll time out after 2 seconds. So if you can't respond with an affirmative in 2 seconds, it will assume you're dead. And this could happen. And here's how, in Java land. If those people have been in Java land, you might have written pieces of code like this, where you basically pulled a connection from the connection pool, or another thread from a thread pool, and you forgot to put it back. That happens a lot in Java. So you won't be able to respond to this probe, because all your threads, which in this case you can see, it's just going to root. It's just loading the root, but you could have it a very specific URL here to talk to your HTTP-based endpoint. And by the way, it's not just HTTP probes, there's also just file system probes. If you have a Fortran application or something like that, where it's looking for a file to show up and expecting a file to come back, you could do that too. But this is actually very nice for a microservice, RESTful microservice. Talk to the API. If the API does not respond, it's probably locked up. It won't respond to users either. So shoot it in the head and restart it someplace else. Okay? And the readiness probe is the second phase down there. And you notice it's mapped to a slightly different path. This is very powerful. You now can write any code you want in that probe behind that command to do what you will. So if you look at the actual Java code again, there is a little bit of logic behind that one, slash health. You can see it right here. Where'd health go? Well, I can't find it. There. So in this case, it's very straightforward. It's returning a 200, but you could have logic here. You could have logic that basically says, connect to my databases, warm up my caches, verify the JMS brokers talking to me, and my Kafka connection is whole. Then I am ready. So prior to that moment, you would be returning something that's not 200. Right? Typically, it's a 500, right, that you would return. So you're going to return a non-200 until you are ready. When you are ready, you return a 200. That means the load balancer can now talk to you. So let's see if we can make this work. Let's actually come in here and watch. Kubectl get pods. Kubectl replace dash F. And then this is my boot. What was it called? My boot. Let's make sure we get the file name right, the one we were just playing with here. My boot deployment, live and ready. So my boot deployment, live, ready, replace that. And you'll notice the old pod is being torn down. The new pod is being created because we have a new set of parameters for dealing with that pod. Let's see here. Can we get our while loop back? While. Let's run our curl command. Notice, did you see those errors we got right away? Because, and you'll, if you also were paying attention, you also saw that it took a while before it said it was running. Because now it's doing the checks. In other words, the first time it was running immediately because it did no checks when it really wasn't ready. So now it's actually, you will only call it when it's ready. So if I come over here now, and let's see if we can do my little dance I did earlier. So let's actually go to version 2. Save, close. Let's see if I did that right. Oh, and I know why I have this error here. Let's do this. Let me show you, and let's see if I can demo this correctly. Let me just go to 2 replicas. Okay, so we're going to get 2 of these guys up. If you want to play the rolling update game, you can't have one thing. You got to have 2 things. So we get 2 of those up, and we should see the load balancing back and forth. All right, so there we go, load balancing between the 2 of them. And remember that host name? See the host name here and host name here. Okay, host name here, hostname here. In other words, the hostname is the pod. The pod is the computer for that application. All right, that's the way to think of it. So now we have two of these. Let's see if we can actually do this again. All right, so let's come over here to view one. Save, close, let me see if it works. Okay, so we went from Aloha. We're still in Aloha, and you notice actually it's trying to bring up the new ones, but what it's doing is it's not tearing down the old one till the new one is ready. One of the new ones is ready, and there we go, it's Namaste. So now you get a clean rolling update. So that's all we actually have time for, but I want to make sure you see the live and readiness probe because that is critical to doing this correctly. You can also, again, watch all this from a video replay standpoint. This was recorded today, as well as I mentioned that there's a recording here as well. You can also join me for a future O'Reilly Live presentation, but that is your quick introduction to how to do basic Kubernetes things. Was that cool? Okay. Make sure you grab access to the slide deck at bit.ly 9 steps awesome. And make sure you grab access to the GitHub repo, and you can git clone that and get started. And again, all the documentation is out there. You can see people will file GitHub issues for me and pull requests, and I need to go look at them. So feel free to do that, and I got to go look at them. But that is your introduction. So thank you so much for that.